The grace of Christ be with you. We have gathered here in person at safer distances from each other here in the sanctuary, and we greet those who have gathered around a computer or a TV at home. May this be a blessing to you as it is to all of us to worship God on this Sunday, October 3rd, in the 2020th year of our Lord. We are delighted to have Kate Rose, who will be providing us with special music as well as singing our hymns. Here in the sanctuary, we cannot sing to keep one another safe. At home, we invite you to sing and to follow along in the liturgy that is found on our webpage. If you're watching there, you can do sort of a split screen or print out a liturgy to follow along today. We're grateful for Kate's ministry here with us, and Max as well on the organ. We are also mindful of today being World Communion Sunday. We had the world spinning over our chancel area and the communion table. Today we celebrate with the world the communion of our Lord Jesus Christ, the sharing of the feast. And if you're at home and do not have yet communion elements, we invite you to go and get those and prepare for that celebration at home. A bit of bread or something munchable, and a sip of wine or juice or whatever have you at home to represent Christ's body and blood and our sharing in that feast of love. Today, following the service, there will be an opportunity for fellowship that happens on Zoom. We encourage you to partake of that if you're so moved. And following that time of fellowship will be an opportunity for you to engage in a conversation, to listen to people who've been a part of our summer sessions talking about how to be an anti-racist. We had a large outpouring of interest in this journey, the difficult and long journey of learning how to be not just not a racist, but an anti-racist, to be engaged in that struggle for the justice that God calls us to and the love of our neighbors as ourselves. So that happens as our first forum, our virtual first forum, at about 11:30 today. And then if you have a pet or a creature in your yard who you would like to have blessed, we are doing the blessing of the animals because today is the closest day to the Feast of St. Francis, the lover of creatures great and small. We are blessing animals today virtually, so you don't even have to bring your cat in a cage down to the front yard, or your little bird that you would never bring outside. That those creatures of yours can be blessed, and that Zoom link is on our church website as well. So we invite you to tune in for the blessing of the animals, and that happens at 12:30 today. Other things are happening today, Bill. Jazz Vespers?
Jazz Vespers, as always, at 5 o'clock.
Yeah.
Good to see that happen.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes in the life that we share together, we vote on different realities. In a democracy, we vote on what is true to some extent. And so we're going to take a little poll. Everyone who believes that today is the 3rd of October, please raise your hands. Everyone who believes it's the 4th of October, please raise your hands. All right, then, the 4th wins. It is the 4th of October. And aren't we glad that we in a democracy are able to do this? So disregard anything on your handouts or anything that you might see in any of the distributions that say that it's the 3rd, because we have just
thank
changed
you.
Reality to the 4th. Okay, that's good, Joe. I want to keep you in line here. Good to see you all who are watching and everybody who's together. Yesterday, we, in a strange sort of way, pretty much filled this room for Walt Robb's service. And it was a wonderful service. I want to thank all the technical people that helped make this happen. And I think we now have figured out how to do a pretty full service. We had 77 people down in here, and many, many, many more watching online. So we're figuring out how to do this thing together and how to make it happen. You'll notice that in the courtyard that there were some books. I'm trying to get rid of about 1,000 books. And if you don't take them, I'm going to throw them away. So that's the best threat I can have. So you'll be seeing tables out there. Thank you for the library committee that's doing that. And please feel free to take it. If you'd like my autograph in the book itself, it's only $100 to the charity of your choice, and hope to make that happen. For those of you who might be here for the first time with the little communion things, they're a little tricky, so you need to look at them very carefully and understand that the clear thing comes off first. So there's two layers of little things that come off, and the top layer is clear, and so don't take off the second one or it just won't work right. So the bread comes off with the little thing on top, and then the second thing is the juice. And it takes just a little bit of figuring out before the thing itself. Like many things in life, we have to prepare for it, which is what we're talking about today. We're talking about a passage from Matthew that's called the mini apocalypse, or part of the mini apocalypse, a small part of the mini apocalypse, in which Jesus talks about the world that is to come. And we're going to talk about the end is near and what that means to us and to our culture. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us worship God.
We do seek to serve God faithfully, and yet we recognize that we often falter. So we gather to receive God's grace anew, part of which includes speaking the truth about our lives. Let us share that truth together in the prayer of confession as printed in your bulletins. With one voice, let us pray. Lord of all, we gather to find your presence again. Forgive us when we have forgotten you and your path. Help us live and share the joy you have given us. Guide us in the ways of peace. For a new day, we pray. Friends, believe this good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven, and by the Holy Spirit empowered to live faithfully the truth that is God's love for the world of which we are a part and in which we participate. Let us share together our response of thanks for this good news, humming for the beauty of the earth. Share our affirmation of faith from our song of hope. With these words we say, God will renew the world through Jesus, who will put all unrighteousness out, purify the works of human hands, and perfect their fellowship in divine love. Christ will wipe away every tear. Death shall be no more. There will be a new heaven and a new earth, and all creation will be filled with God's glory. Come, Lord Jesus, we are open to your Spirit. We await your full presence. Our world finds rest in you alone. You may be seated.
Oh, my tomorrows
Our first lesson comes from Isaiah chapter 5, verses 1 through 7. Let us pray. Guide us, O Lord, by your word and Holy Spirit. Amen. Let me sing for my beloved, my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved has a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it out of stones and planted it with the choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it and hewed out a wine vat in it. He expected it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I had not done for it? When I expected it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste. It shall not be pruned or hoed, and it shall be overgrown with briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his pleasant planting. He expected justice, but saw bloodshed, righteousness, but heard a cry.
Well, I'm going to talk to the children for just a minute. Adults can listen in, but this is really more for children. When I was in elementary school, I went to Mary Crest Elementary School, and I lived right across the street from the school. I mean, right across the street. I could get up when the bell rang, and I could still get to class on time. And I would do all sorts of things. I had a little parking lot for bikes because you weren't allowed to ride bikes to Mary Crest School, so I would charge people a nickel to park their bike in my yard, and then they would walk to school. I had a wonderful time. And this was grades 1 through 6. But in grade 7, I had to get on a bus. I mean, so it wasn't like I was just walking. I had to get on a bus. And somebody, one of the older boys, told me that, oh, the first day you ride on the bus, they beat you up. And I was afraid. I had never taken a bus to school before, and the idea that I was going to get beat up, I'd never been beat up before. I had sort of didn't even know what that meant. And that I was going to get beat up the first day I rode the bus, I signed up to take French class because it was before the bus got there and my parents had to drive me to school just so I wouldn't have to ride the bus. But this kid told me that they beat, and he sort of, it wasn't true. Nobody got beat up. Maybe, I don't know, maybe a long time ago somebody had, but nobody got beat up on the bus. It was a wrong story. It made me feel afraid of the future. All of sixth grade, I was worried about getting beat up. But sometimes there's problems and rumors of problems, and people will say things to make you afraid. And a lot of the times, it's just not true. Right. So here's a Bible passage from Matthew. It's a story of Jesus talking about the end times. And it's kind of upsetting. Some of it's kind of upsetting. And Jesus says, don't be afraid a couple of times. And it's hard not to be. Listen for the word of God. When Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives, his disciples came to him privately saying, tell us when the end will be and what will be the sign of the coming and of the end of the age. And Jesus answered them, beware no one leads you astray, for many will come in my name saying, I am the Messiah, and they will lead many astray. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not alarmed. For this must take place, but the end is not yet. Nation will rise up against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places, but all this is the beginning of the birth pangs. They will hand you over to be tortured and will put you to death, and you will be hated by all nations because of my name. Many will fall away, and they will betray one another and hate one another. And many false prophets will arise and lead many astray. And because of the increase of lawlessness, the love of many will grow cold. But anyone who endures to the end will be saved. And this good news of the kingdom will be proclaimed throughout the world as a testimony to all the nations. And then the end will come. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, Scripture is full of prophecies and predictions about the future. Sometimes they are apocalyptic, like the passage here with us today. Sometimes they are simply articulations of natural consequences of behavior, something like we try to instill in children. You know, if you keep doing that, worms will grow in your stomach. We tell things to children, it's like they keep doing bad things will happen. Sometimes these prophecies are a kind of comfort about God's presence with us in the future, no matter what. So bad things are going to happen, but it's going to be okay. Don't worry about it. And sometimes there's all three of these things, natural consequences, apocalypse, and God's going to be with you, all of these things about the future in different sorts of emphasis at different times in Scripture. Jesus talks about the future and the big picture many times, many occasions about the coming tribulation or what will happen after he leaves them or what the kingdom of heaven will look like. Lots of future talk, Jesus. And he does this for preparation and perspective. He wants the disciples' hearts to be prepared, preparation. He wants them to be prepared for the struggles that may be ahead. Really, almost practical. When you know that the zombie apocalypse is coming, you buy lots of Frosted Flakes because you want to be prepared for the zombie apocalypse. And do you like Frosted Flakes? So, and this is what some of what Jesus was getting. You have to sort of be ready, be prepared for this thing. You prepare for the spirit. You prepare your spirit as well for challenge and discomfort. And you're sort of ready for this. We might love to prepare for a cherished vacation. I mean, I love to plan for a vacation. It's joyful to sort of get ready for that special trip, especially these days, whenever that's going to happen. But just as important is what we do to get ready for adversity. What we get ready for that time that we might not like so much. Maybe we save up money in a rainy day fund. Maybe we get used to simply the idea that things won't be sweetness and light all the time. Not pessimism exactly, but a realistic hedge against hard times. In addition to preparation for Jesus talking about the future in these dramatic sorts of ways, Jesus and the prophets put forth these notions and these images as a sense of perspective, a broader view of life that moves us in the direction of God's history. Sort of like it's easier to cope with two-year-olds when you get the sense that they won't always be that way. Have you ever spent much time with two-year-olds? If you imagine that they were always going to be that way, you might turn to despair. But you know, oh no, this is a stage they're going through, the no stage or the whatever. And so that perspective allows you to deal with the no stage or the whatever stage of growing up children are in. We can live with the challenge of a 12-hour flight. Remember we used to take airplane trips places? 12 hours, several times I've been on trips to really wonderful places that were just horrible traveling journeys, trapped in these little seats. But I could live with the challenge because I knew it was taking me to a beloved place. This is the perspective that Jesus is often trying to give his disciples right up to the end, that there's something ahead. The end is near. At the Last Supper, Jesus said, "Do this in remembrance of me." A lot of communion tables have it right across the front. Ours doesn't, but many do this in remembrance of me. And it wasn't in some sort of prideful sense that Jesus was going, "I want you to remember me." It was, Jesus was meeting that, remember my teachings. Remember who I am when things get tough. This nourishment will help you get through these things. Remember what's important. Remember me. This perspective. Will this passage from Matthew about the end apocalypse and the end being near is relevant to my life and it's relevant to our life? Next week is my last Sunday preaching. The end is near. The familiar patterns of my life will change dramatically, presumably for the better, but you never know. There will be sadness and gnashing of teeth and changing of diapers. What if I have to change diapers all the time for the rest of my life? You never know. Could be. Yes, could happen. And for all of us, there are things going on. There are some unpleasant things going on that can be compared to other times of devastation in history of the world. There's the COVID strangeness. There's the environmental crisis. There's a worldwide battle against racism and classism going on. It's not just the strangeness in the United States. All over the world, there is this battle against small-mindedness or big-picture-ness. It's happening everywhere. And these three crises are piling up. And they threaten to bring even more conflict and pain. It doesn't take much insight to know that some of our friends are going to die in the next year. Doesn't take much insight to know that the election is going to get more dramatic. You know, there's more strangeness ahead in the election business. It doesn't take much to know that there's going to be huge weather disruptions, that there's going to, Michigan, the waters are going to get even higher. There's going to be storms and tornadoes and wildfires. It doesn't take much to know about our culture to know that people will try and make us afraid. And they will often succeed even when we know what they're up to. Even when I knew I shouldn't listen to that guy when I was in sixth grade, I was still afraid. We're in a funny time. Things have piled up. Remember Bob Dylan's words? Come gather round people wherever you roam and admit that the waters around you have grown and accept it that soon you'll be drenched to the bone. If your time to you is worth saving, then you better start swimming or you'll sink like a stone. For the times, they are a-changin'. Now, Bob Dylan wasn't being mean, I don't think, but he was just saying that the world is about to come to an end. Ah! But Jesus tells us, like my retirement, after some rather dramatic adjustment, it will lead to a better place. Jesus calls this disturbing message here the good news. Were you listening? All these horrible things? And at the end it says, and this good news you will take. I guess the good news is that this leads us to a whole different place. Knowing that God's word will prevail in the midst of all kinds of upheaval is a bit comforting to know that God, the good news is of God's perseverance and presence, and the times, God will be with us when the times they are a-changing. Our nation has weathered xenophobia, isolationism before. Our nation has weathered McCarthyism, lies of the worst type, and we have survived. And just like this place has burned to the ground, looked as if it were over, from the ashes rose a great and strong institution. We will get through this. As people, we have survived all sorts of things, not only as a nation, but as a people. We have survived strangeness in our lives, and only you know how strange it got. We have survived adolescence when the times were changing. We have survived strangeness as functional adults. And God's hand brought us through. The end is near! Hot diggity dog!
Oh,
Beloved in the Lord Jesus Christ, the Holy Supper which we are about to celebrate is a feast of remembrance, of communion, and of hope in the name of the one who lives. Let us share together our opening dialogue. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Holy and right it is, and our joyful duty, to give thanks to you at all times and in all places, O Lord, our Creator, almighty and everlasting God. You made the heavens with all their host, the earth with all its plenty. You have given us life and being and preserve us by your providence. Yet you have shown to us the fullness of your love by sending into the world the eternal Word, Jesus Christ, made flesh for us and our salvation. For the precious gift of this mighty Savior who has reconciled us to you, we praise and bless you, O God. With your whole church on earth and all the company of heaven, we worship and adore your glorious name, saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Most righteous God, we remember in this supper the perfect sacrifice offered once on the cross by our Lord Jesus Christ for the sin of the whole world. In the joy of his resurrection and in expectation of his coming again, we offer ourselves to you as holy and living sacrifices. Send your Holy Spirit upon us, we pray, and stir up your Spirit among us, that the bread which we break and the cups which we bless may be unto us the communion of the body and blood of our Lord. And grant that, as we share in this feast, we may be joined together in the unity of the faith and grow up in every way into Christ our Lord. And as these grains have been gathered from many fields in their many places into these pieces of bread, and these grapes from many hills in many places into these cups of blessing, so too gather your whole church from the ends of the earth with all creation into your kingdom. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Our Savior, on the same night that he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. And gave it to his friends, saying, Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same manner, after they had supped, our Lord took the cup, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Drink you all of it. The gifts of God for the people of God. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-loving God, we thank you for this supper shared in your spirit, which makes us new and fresh and strong and brings us life eternal. We pledge ourselves to serve you even as in Christ you have served us. May this meal so comfort and inspire us that we might live with challenges that are to come. Live to see your face in our world and in our lives. Be with us as we gather to combat every power that might try to hurt or divide us. Be with us, Almighty God, as we face the challenges of our season. We pray for those who face the challenges of the COVID virus that plagues the world. We pray for researchers and doctors and nurses who care for us. We pray for all of those who are infected with this disease. We pray for the families of those who have died. We pray for the struggles of those who fear. We pray for those who have to work in unsafe places because they need a way of living, how to feed their families. We pray, Almighty God, for all the challenges that this brings us. Help us to gather peace from your spirit so that we know that nothing can separate us from your love and that we can overcome every power to hurt or divide us. We pray for the political climate of our nation and the world. We pray that you would lead us into ways of peace, that we would speak to each other words of respect. Help us not to listen to rumors and lies, but to lift us and our hearts to the principles of the common good that you have shown us, so that nothing may hurt or divide us. We pray, Almighty God, for the crisis and the environment that we face. We pray that you would give us wisdom and courage to face the strangeness of the days so that we might be able to make the changes that are necessary in our lives and in our common lives to heal this world that you have given us. Pray your presence with us against every power to hurt or divide us. Be with us as a congregation as we figure out how to do new things. Bring your melodies into our hearts, even if we can't sing them. Help us to rejoice in new ways. Lead, guide, and direct us and those who watch and listen in ways they never imagined. Be with us as your people. Lead, guide, and direct us into the future, and we will give you the glory. Lead us into that place that we yearn for. Help us to know that the end of suffering is near and that we can be led into your kingdom. Be with us as this congregation and as individual followers of Jesus Christ. Help us to live the life he showed us. Heal our hearts so that we might be true disciples. Be with us in this journey that Jesus Christ showed us, the way, his path, and his words. Be with us in the words he taught his disciples to pray, saying, "Our Father,
hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And
lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen."